I may not seem to have a lot to say here, but maybe I have more than a lot to say. It may seem that your life is not profound, but actually, it may be more profound than you realize. This is something to consider, is it not? I'm going to relay a little story to you of what happened today, and you can sort of follow along and just think, hey, you know, maybe there is, my life is so deep that it's just, I'm missing it. So, I did taping this afternoon, did some work, it's getting late, and suddenly I had this feeling like I need to go to a golf course, just to start moving. I haven't played golf in a long time. Been to the driving range once, and that's it. And I said, wow, am I ready for this? And I said, well, why not? But it was late in the day. It's like 5 o'clock. I said, this is crazy. It's too late. So I said, well, let me just give it a try. Went in there, tried to make reservations on the computer. The computer didn't work. The internet didn't work. Like a technology failure is horrible. So I just said, forget it. And I said, well, I'll restart my computer. All right, I restarted the computer. Finally was able to get in there. Now it's like 5:20. Rush hour traffic. I said, I'm not going to get out till after 6 o'clock. It gets dark at 7:30. That's ridiculous. I said, I'm not going. Forget it. I had the clubs in the car. I was all ready to go. I said, no way. That's stupid. And for some reason, at the last second, I said, wow, maybe the Holy Spirit wants me to go. I'll go. So I made a reservation online, and I took off and got there after 6 o'clock, late for my reservation. 6 in the afternoon. Who goes out at 6 out in the afternoon? Well, I went to the desk. I said, I'm sorry, you know, the traffic, I'm a little late, and just, wow. He said, oh, wow, it's a good thing you just got here. He said, I was just ready to pick up the phone and call the cart barn where they keep the golf carts and tell them to lock up all the carts. He says, because we don't allow anybody to go out after 6 o'clock. I said, oh my gosh, it's after 6. And he says, that's okay. We'll get you out. So I just made it within like a minute. Otherwise, I couldn't go out at all. So I'm waiting for this. He said, someone will bring the cart out for you. So I'm waiting for the cart. So what am I doing? But I had some sort of idea. You know what? It's late in this world, isn't it? It's late in my life, actually. It's late in this world. It's very late. And I have a feeling that many of us are feeling like, what's the use? What's the use? It's too late anyway, right? I mean, for me, like, what if my life becomes really, really nice now or something? Well, it's too late. You know, how many years do I have left? What's the use? Why even bother? Just forget it. Or in this world, the troubles of this world, the interlopers that are here, extraterrestrials taking over the planet, actually, have done such a thorough job of it that, you know, it's a sad, sad situation here, really. And what can we do? It's too late. It's too late, is it not? I said, well, maybe, but maybe not. Maybe not. So finally the cart comes out. Someone drives it up. And he says, here you go, sir. That's a young man. Here you go, sir. Pin location 3. Very nice young man. Just like, I'm kind of talking, so I get ready to go. Okay, he puts the bag there and everything. I'm ready to go. Talk. Yeah, great. And I just sort of noticed, like, this young man was like, seemingly, he didn't have any problems. He was extraordinary. Balanced, the features, everything was just like incredible. You don't meet someone like this, like a full-on blue blood, you know, just like born into this world seemingly with Teflon or something. It was just like incredibly great attitude. and just poise and calm, and you don't meet someone like that hardly ever, actually. So it was striking to me. After he left, I said, well, wait a minute, who was that? Yeah, you just don't run into someone like that. So I said, wow, this is kind of, different here. What's going on? So I took off and said, here goes, whatever. I had to change my swing months ago because my back and hip, everything is, so terrible. I can't play. And I tried to do something that was different that would work. I thought it might work. I don't know. Well, boom, right down the middle. Wow. And then also changed, my iron swing. Boom, right on the green. Second hole, boom, beautiful. Boom, right on the green. Third hole, same. It's like, wow. So I just proceeded to go really fast. Nobody's out there. And I just hit the ball, incredibly well. This is one of the most difficult golf courses in the world, actually. And the ball just kept going in the middle, just fantastic. And I was just like, this is easy. I was in a big hurry, running everywhere. So, on one hole, like the 12th hole or something, some man's driving a cart. He comes up to me, coming towards me. He says, hey, did you find an iPhone? Did you find an iPhone anywhere? And I said, oh, sorry, I didn't. He goes, oh, man, I lost my iPhone. He goes back, going backwards. And I said, very interesting. And I thought, maybe I should have helped him. But I said, no, let him deal with it. Let him deal with the technology, the situation. He's going backwards. Very profound, actually. Because I felt like maybe I'm a bad person. I should have said, I'll help you look for your iPhone. Maybe I'll bring my phone and call your phone. Maybe it will hear it somewhere. But I said, no, let those who are into technology, let them deal with the troubles that it brings. I'm going to keep going forward. I thought that was very profound. Then I was able to make it, it just got dark. They said, have the carts in by 8 o'clock. I got the cart in by 8:01. Played 14 and a half holes, skipped a few. And came away just feeling like this is some very profound situation, really. I remember quite some time ago, maybe in 2004, I had this situation where there was, at the beach, where it was just horrible, cold, miserable, and we wanted to get out of there. And the gist of it was, I said, let's go, and then this came up. Let's wait about 15 minutes. I said, okay. And suddenly the pressure gradient, something changed, and this breeze came through. Little tiny trickles of breeze started coming through. I said, what is that? Some kind of weird little trickle of breeze just kind of goes past your face, warm. And then another little trickle of breeze, like a flow, a beautiful flow, sort of just goes past you. And you look up, it's miserable. I say, what the heck is that? And then suddenly this flow started happening of air. This beautiful, warm, sparkling, clear air started just flowing past us. And it kept flowing and flowing and stronger and stronger and stronger. And a miracle happened. All of that horrible atmosphere that was driving us off the beach, we said, we're going to go home, this is it. It all got completely pushed out to the sea. And this place was this most incredible clarity. Before, you could barely see the sun. It was all hazed out by all the spray and moisture, cold moisture in the air. It was hideous. Now, the sun was sparkling like a jewel in the sky. Everything was sparkling. It was just like, everyone was just going, whoa, what happened? I knew at that moment, something's going to happen, either in my life or in the world or something. And the key was wait about 15 minutes. It wasn't quite 15 minutes. It was almost 15 minutes when this breeze came through. Well, I said, it's probably talking about 2015. Okay. It's probably minutes. It's really referring to years. Wait until about 2015. So we're almost there at 2000. It's about 2015. And I would not, I would expect that there is going to be something tremendous is going to happen, actually. That just will just be like, wow, this is just truly amazing. And I played like 14 and a half holes, right? Almost 15 holes. I managed to get in almost 15 holes before going home. I said, wow, that's pretty symbolic. 18th hole, it's dark. I just said, okay, let me just try and just slam the drive. And I just said, wow, I don't know where it went, whatever. And I just drove up there. I look up there, way up towards the green, right exactly in the middle of the fairway, just perfect. There's the ball. I'm just like, whoa, what's going on? It seems like I could do no wrong. So what does it mean? I've always thought that golf is life. It reveals your life to you, actually. And so this golf course had destroyed me earlier in my life, and I vowed never to return. I lost over $500 of equipment there just because I was so rattled. I forgot it. You know, I forgot a sweater, a jacket, two wedges. It just destroyed me. And now it was like I just blew through it, you know, just like nothing. It's like a piece of cake, whatever. And it didn't even affect me at all. Nothing didn't even affect me in the slightest bit. So what does that mean? I don't know, but it's pretty interesting, pretty profound. So what is all the symbology? They're just ready to close, and you just managed to barely make it. Well, I think that we're at the time in this world now where we're just going to barely make it. And what we need to do is we need to realize it's better to get some refreshment than none at all. Yeah, it's true, it's very late. Yeah, it's true that we don't have long. Yeah, it's true that the darkness is coming soon. Yeah, all of this is true. But it's worth it to get just that little reassurance. And what happened was, I mean, I feel like very reassured. Like, you know, if that course can't intimidate me, what course can, really? It seems like I have the game to handle it now. Who would have thought, you know? I was quite surprised, actually. It seems like my swing is totally unorthodox. Totally unorthodox. Everything is totally unorthodox. I had to change everything because of the issues and problems I've had. You know, nobody swings like that. Nobody positions the ball like that. Nobody does it this way at all. And yet it's just like, I was just crushing it consistently. I mean, it's just like everything was going where I wanted to do. Everything was happening the way I wanted it to happen. And so, hey, very fascinating. Now, so this is just something that just happened like this, but very profound, actually. Now, maybe your life is... what's happening in your life is actually incredibly profound, but very unexpected. This is just so unexpected. And so sometimes the profundity comes in your life in a way that's, you just don't expect it. And only in hindsight do you look back and say, wow. Or who was that young man? He was like saintly. He really was like saintly. And in just a natural way, you just don't come across that. And he's the one that set me off and reassured me. You know, he had a very reassuring presence about him. Quite amazing. And maybe that's sort of like our true self. You know, someone who had not been contaminated by the demands of this agreement that we have for this world of problems, so we can come and turning our backs on God. Maybe that's how we are really, like that, just clear, very clear, very, very clear. No sense of nervousness about him. No nervousness, just clear, very clear, calm and clear. So, is it worth giving it a try? I'm feeling like, you know, what's the use? What's the use in even trying to help to do anything here in the world now? What's the use? The time's basically, we got 2 hours. We got 2 years, actually, in this world. We got 2 years. There's a lot of people that know that. We got 2 years. A little less than 2 years, actually, now. Just like I had a little less than 2 hours. I teed off at 6:15, got the card in by 8 o'clock. So we have just less than 2 years now before the darkness is really hits, you know, yeah. So it's such a little time, but maybe it's enough to just like really reassure ourselves somehow, right? Because now I feel like, you know, maybe I can, I don't know, maybe I can, well, we'll see. Maybe I can play any golf course, maybe everything will hold up, maybe this is my game now. Maybe this is just, it is what it is, this is now my game. Possible. It's possible. Really is possible. Yeah, it's a very strong game, actually. I just almost out of nowhere. Out of just, wow. Super unorthodox. A swing coach would look at that and say, whoa, 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 you're doing everything wrong. Doing everything wrong there. What are you doing? Putting the ball up with your stance with your irons and going like this. You can't do that. That's all wrong. That's all wrong. That's all wrong. And yet the results are like beautiful. The results are just was incredible. Holy cow. That course just destroys confidence. And I was just slamming the ball up on the greens, just, you know, right there. Incredibly difficult shots. And it's just like, boom, there it is. I don't know. So somehow it seems like I've got game. It came out of, where did it come from? Well, Forty years of working on it, I guess. Enough to say, hey, if it's unorthodox and it works, use it. It seems like the orthodoxy of this world is what really drags us down, actually. The orthodox teachings, I say most teachings on this planet are egoic. They're egoic, they're dualistic, they're not true. Most. And if you actually accept true teachings, you will seem very unorthodox. Now, I've been feeling very discouraged, but what is discouraged? Is it my spirit that's discouraged, or is it the ego that's discouraged? I'm not really sure. Maybe it's the ego, actually. It's possible. The ego just saying, I just want to die, this is horrible, I can never succeed, you know, just trying to get me to be suicidal, you know. And I just say, well, I don't know, maybe I'm about ready to succeed, and you, ego, are about ready to be not needed. I don't know. So when you're down, when you really get down, and which is very possible now, right? I mean, I would say most subscribers to this channel have had episodes of depression in their life, and they know what it's like, and they know like it can bite them. And so I would suggest, when you start to feel that bite coming on, just say, no, wait a minute, wait, just a minute. Is this really a depression? Am I depressed, or is the ego depressed? Am I actually succeeding to such an extent that the ego is just like getting distraught, saying, how can I keep them? Because remember, the ego thinks it's protecting us from total chaos. It's not. It's not at all. It's a self-appointed guardian of us, you know, but the Holy Spirit says, oh, everything's fine, don't worry. So I'm aware that there's some really, he's like really feeling like it's gonna be crushed or something. I'm not gonna make, I don't know, just really worried, really worried. So this is where all your training comes in into play, where you keep your poise, you keep your calm, you keep your silence. You say, the only problem I have is a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. Instant centering like that. Don't jump to conclusions that you necessarily are going to fail. It may be the failure of the ego that is coming, see? That's more likely in my case, isn't it? I say that's much more likely than I'm going to fail. You know, how could I fail? It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. I may am able to really appreciate without Jesus said, try these various, he made these various statements in Journey Beyond Words. And then he said, you can actually tell where you're at by if you have resistance to what I just told you. And I read it all, and it's like no resistance. I said, "This is great. This is fine. No, I don't feel any resistance." And he said, "He said most of you are going to feel very strong resistance to some of this, and that'll let you know how to work on your value. What do you value?" And I just read it, and I just said, "No resistance." So, from what Jesus said, that means that I have to be, far along. Have to be. So how could some great failure be coming? It doesn't make any sense. Now, I'm aware there's a different way to look at the world, and this is what's emerging. This is really what's emerging. Where this is just a place, where people come who are so dispirited, they feel it's impossible to ever resolve a continuity fear, and therefore they want to be distracted by the problems of this world. There's a whole new way of looking at the world that completely turns it inside out and a different perspective. And that is arising in me. And it's so colossal, it's so dramatically different. And I think I'm saying like, wow, maybe I can't handle this, but I believe I can. And it's starting to come out in my videos, bit by bit by bit by bit, it's starting to come out in the videos. But I haven't not yet really been able to express it clearly yet because it's such a shocker, really. But I will be able to express it. I just have to keep my cool here. And not struggle with it. When it's ready to come out, it'll come out. And you'll be able to hear it. And it'll be a shocker. It'll be a shocker for sure. So, your life is maybe way more profound than you realize. Don't get depressed. You might actually be succeeding beyond anybody's expectations. And they're the ones who are going to fail. They're going to fail to keep you bound to deception, bound to despair. They're going to fail to keep you bound to despair. This planet is really a place of despair, actually. The people here despair, the spirits here despair of ever resolving the continuity fear. They don't think it's possible, which is why they just basically deny that it even exists and try to distract themselves with all the effort and problems of this world, right? This is an ideal place to be distracted from the continuity problem, from recognizing it. It's an ideal place for that. And maybe all this ideology here is going to fail to distract me. It's going to fail. And that's shocking for people. Because then they got to question it, like, hey, this world really isn't a safe hiding place for them, I can't even hide from it here, from success here. I can't even hide from it here. Wow. What do I do? I don't really want to, go to some other place even worse. Maybe I better really start looking at this, and maybe I can succeed. Maybe, you know, who knows what can happen here? I don't know. So, for a very profound time we're living in right now, actually, in the world. Super profound. Everybody knows it. And even when I hit some bad shots there, which happened, I didn't care. I said, I don't care. I don't have time to worry about that stuff. I don't have any time to worry about it. Just keep moving, keep moving. I actually hit every shot good, just the alignment there is so blind and everything. Yeah, I said, that should have been good. Where'd it go? I don't know. I don't care. I don't have time to worry about it. Take a drop. Keep moving. Didn't keep score. Didn't need to. The greens were not good. For some reason, and I didn't have time to line up the putts. Forget it. Just get on the green, hit the ball, go. And just keep moving. That's fine. It could be that way in this world. At this point, I'm getting a lot of backlash within my psyche. You know, saying wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong. All this stuff. Like you know, you got to do it the orthodox way. What you're saying can't be right. You know, it's all this pressure. But what is that? Where is that coming from? Is that coming from me? Or is that coming from the world? Is that what the world wants me? Is that the pressure the world puts on you to get you to say what it wants it to say? You know, most likely. I'm trying to break bad habits. I'm not looking at the news. I'm not looking at any comments on forums, etc. I'm just staying away from that, actually. Staying away from it, trying to make good habits. Interesting. Today, a very unknown pitcher, actually, Yasmero Petit. I call him Yas Petit for the San Francisco Giants. Set an all-time major league record. How long has baseball been around? 127 years or something like that, 130 or maybe even more. In the history of Major League Baseball, and all the pitchers who have ever pitched in all this time, nobody had ever recorded more than 45 consecutive batters. No pitcher had ever retired more than 45 consecutive batters. And today, Yasmero Petit retired his 46th consecutive batter. No hits, no walks, no errors. 46 consecutive batters. That's an all-time record. And he's like an unknown, really. I know him. He plays for the Giants. And I was watching it, actually. I was able to watch the last couple of batters, and it was so cool. It was like, wow. He was totally aware of it, and he totally wanted it, because he lost a perfect game before. The last batter of the game got a hit, and he lost a perfect game. It was heartbreaking. Now he's got the all-time Major League record, which I think is even cooler than a perfect game, retiring 46 consecutive batters. You know, so I just said, you know what? Nobody saw that coming. Nobody was even aware of that. And yet suddenly, boom, here's an all-time record. A very significant one. I always felt that this was a very significant record. Mark Burley had the record, and Jenks had a good mark, and then Jim Barr had the National League record. I remember listening to Jim Barr when he set that record back, I think, in the 70s. I always thought it was super significant. And then Yasmero Petit breaks the all-time record today in hardly a ripple, you know. But for the cognoscenti, you know, that's very amazing. To retire 46 consecutive Major League batters is truly astonishing. And maybe that's a sign. Maybe something truly astonishing will happen in the world now. You know, maybe there's somebody been toiling away. Nobody knows about them. That they're going to somehow, you know, set the bar real high or something. Maybe there in this world there are those who are, you know, we're totally unaware of, are very low on the radar, who will suddenly, you know, set the bar super high. People say, you know, huh, that's pretty amazing. What was that? The comments on that were pretty, hardly any comments. People kind of just said, oh, yeah, well. But I know that that's never been done before. Every single picture in history is never, never, ever done that before. It's interesting. The Giants are setting all these high, these amazing marks. Madison Bumgarner pitched one of the best games ever pitched a couple days ago. The manager, Bruce Bochy, got a 1,600th win. Probably will put him in the Hall of Fame. Tim Hudson got his 2,000th strikeout. And there's all these, and Petit, the next day, Petit sets this all-time major league record. And I'm just taking notes like, hey, you know, suddenly things are going terrible, and suddenly there's just major milestones are being reached. Major milestones. Ah. Yeah. Bumgarner started. The writers are just raving about it. So this could have been one of the best pitch games in the history of baseball, actually. And it could have been, actually. Is that good? And the funny thing is, I saw the first inning of it. And he got hit hard. Three balls hit real hard. One great play was made. And I said, you know what? I think he might pitch a perfect game. Or a no-hitter. It's possible. It's possible he could get close to a no-hitter per game. I just feel like it can happen. And then I actually went and taped and never saw the game. I went back after taping, the game was over. And there were all this hubbub and commotion. And I said, what happened? Did he pitch a perfect game? He said, one hit away from a perfect game. Struck out 13. Was just absolutely on another level. Just a level that very few pitchers have ever reached. He was that great. And it just came out of nowhere. See, he's been terrible at home all year. So these things, you know, suddenly there's a constellation of like major milestones and accomplishments and amazing, tremendously high accomplishments, and most people are just kind of hardly taking note of it. This is on a little scale, but sometimes foreshadowing happens on a little scale in little ways that we notice, right? So there's all these things I'm noticing. There seem to be foreshadowing. Suddenly major milestones are going to be reached in this world. And maybe a few people will notice, maybe not many actually. But it may start seeping in. Those who are supposed to notice will notice it. Let's put it that way. Those who are supposed to notice it will notice it and say, hey, you know, I noticed Petit after that near perfect game. I say, hey, this guy is capable of just dealing. I mean, he's capable of it. And suddenly here he comes back the next year and does this astonishing feat. And it's just truly astonishing. But he's a nobody in terms of baseball. He's a nobody. But he's not really a nobody. You see, a nobody doesn't do what he just did. You see, that's the funny thing of the world, right? I mean, it may be that they're just these nobodies come out, you know, just suddenly these nobodies are enlightened, you know. And the world said, well, he's a swingman, middle relief, you know, he's never done anything in the big leagues. Look at his salary, he's like next to nothing, and yeah, we don't see anything here. He just did something absolutely extraordinary. And you don't do that just by luck. You don't retire 46 consecutive big league hitters through luck. And you know, like for today, you don't smash the ball the way I was smashing it in the fairway. You don't do that through luck. You got game there. You got game. So don't despair in the world really yet. Don't let despair overtake you. It could be that there are those in this world who just, you know, they're just finding themselves. They're just finding themselves and have been finding themselves. And it may just emerge that, you know, they've got the stuff. They've got the stuff. And people will say, well, we only got 2 years left until darkness descends. What's the use? What's the use? I mean, it was just a crazy thing. Nobody goes out at 6 o'clock. I've never done anything like that. I said, this is ridiculous. Teed off at 6:15 in the evening. What is that? That's eccentric. But I caught up to other groups. I even played through a group. I was able to get most of what I wanted to do. I got it all accomplished. Got it all accomplished there. So I think that there may be those who emerge in this world as enlightened. There may be those who have the stuff. They really do. And most of the world is going to say it's too late. It's too late. But there will be some who will say, you know what? Better late than never. Better late than never. If we just do it fast, we should be able to get what we need to get the reassurance that we need. So we know that, yeah, we're on the right path. Yeah, this is what's true. Great, we can go now in this direction, and everything's going to be fine. But it's certainly going to be a fast track sort of situation for us in the world now. There's no question about it. There's no more time for anything but fast track. I mean, I was running out there. Bam, hit the ball, tee it up, hit it, boom, boom, boom. Run down on the green, putt, putt, run off the green, jump in the car. Just boom, 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 boom. Just, you know, very fast golf. I'm used to this. I've done a lot of that, playing super fast. Can play a full round in under 2 hours. Maybe I think I did it once in an hour, 45 minutes or something. That's not that great, but it's still fast. And there's some people, professional, who just, you know, do it really fast. But no, I'm not talking about that. But so, maybe don't despair. Maybe there is barely enough time to really clear it out, you know, just to really say, you know what, we got the right stuff here. And this is how I feel. I feel like it's so late in the game, and there's just been nothing really come along. I just feel like, wow, it's too late. It's too late. It's too late. That's how I felt about going out there. Interestingly, the traffic wasn't as terrible as I thought. Once I went past a certain place, it thinned out very nicely, actually. There's another something quite profound. I thought it would just be hideous traffic the whole way. And no, it was only about halfway. The traffic was a third of the way. Traffic was bad. Getting on the freeway was really bad, very bad. But after that, thinned out, I went full speed the whole rest of the way. So I actually got there sooner than I expected, by maybe 15 minutes or so sooner than I expected. So it may not be quite as bad as we think in this world. It may not be. The trouble may not be quite as bad as we think. We actually may have enough time. We may actually get done what we need to get done. So this is all reassuring talk here. I certainly pray that the miracles are like a river for us, you know, and the miracles. Somehow our way has been cleared for us, and somehow it happens for us, for those who really want to take a second look at this whole situation. Take a second look at the world, actually. What is this world really? You know, take a second look at it. It's far different than we've been told, that's for sure. It's definitely, there's a turnaround to what this world is and the purpose, whatever, what's going on here, really. And so we can take a second look at that and just say, you know what? That fits. That fits. I think this all fits together now. It all fits together. And then you realize, hey, I am competent. I am competent. I'm not going to be destroyed by the universe. I've got the game. You know, I've got the game for the universe. Whatever the universe wants, thinks it can throw at me or something. I see it. It's all, I see it in a very different way now. And I'm not into impossible. This insight is surfacing for me, surfacing. Let's see if I can, you know, allow it to surface so you can, so I can share it here. So don't give up, don't despair. That despair is the ego. The ego saying, I almost won, but I'm about ready to lose. I almost persuaded, you know, this world to turn from the light entirely, but I lost at the last second. I lost. So maybe the ego's like really nervous about it. It's going to lose at the very end. Well, yeah, it may, absolutely. The ego thinks the trap is set, and you see the extraterrestrials that are here on the mental plane, manipulating the planet, manipulating people here. They're very, very clever at what they do. They're very advanced at the skills that they have. They're taking this planet over for, they want its resources for sure. They want to turn us into slaves for sure. And they want us to do all the work for them, and they want to get everything out of this planet. They want to get everything from this planet they can possibly get. And they're very clever and very, very practiced and proficient at what they do. But they view us as so stupid that it's a fait accompli. You know, they're going to succeed for sure. And so really, they think that they're being very clever, and actually it's obvious what they're doing. It's just they think we're too stupid to notice, or we don't even care, which is true. Most people don't notice, but some do. And they don't really expect any trouble. They really don't. So they have to have this attitude like this that is very intimidating, because they seem very confident that, you know, you can't do anything to circumvent what they're doing. It's not possible. You're a stupid human. You know, there's nothing you can do. And this is very paralyzing, this kind of confidence they have. They have the confidence of feeling that we always win. You know, we always win. So we're going to win this time too, for sure, without any question. They don't even question it. So it'll come as a very big surprise to them that things may not go the way that they expect. that's the price they pay for overconfidence, I guess. That's the price they pay for not factoring in the Holy Spirit into their supercomputers. But how do you write software for the Holy Spirit? See, what's the algorithm for the Holy Spirit that they put in the computers? There isn't any. So they're conveniently overlooking that. But their confidence is stifling. It is so stifling. Wow, and intimidating. That it gets to everybody. It's unnerving. Their certitude that things are going to go exactly the way that they want them to go here for them. They're so certain of it that we almost think like, wow. And then we fall in line with their certitude about how things are supposed to go here. They say things are supposed to go the way that we want them to go, because they always go the way we want them to go. Therefore, it is manifest destiny. You know, they're teaching. They're teaching us. This is our destiny. This is our manifest. This is God's destiny for the planet. Of course, they're teaching that this is God's destiny for the planet. That we represent God, and here's God's plan for this planet. We're going to bring about this unity in the planet. You know, and everybody getting on the same page in New World Religion, which is emphasized the form instead of the content. All this stuff they're telling us is they say is God's destiny for this planet. It's helping us ascend. It's helping us shed our bad negative karma. It's helping. They present it like, market it like it's some huge leap forward for humanity. And so most humanity is saying, wow, you know, yeah, we really need to do this. And all the while is a trap that everyone's falling into slavery, servitude, idolatry, worshiping form, and ultimately, you know, having this planet under the dominion of those who do not deal kindly with planets or people on them at all. But the way it's being marketed is it's God is for this, you know. Not only that, it's you have no choice. This is what's going to happen to this planet. There isn't any other option. Well, they forget about the Holy Spirit. You see, they have a habit of doing that, actually. Because the Holy Spirit, of course, resolves the continuity problem. And they don't believe the continuity problem can be resolved. Therefore, they don't want to even pay the slightest attention. They want to deny it completely. Deny the continuity problem completely, you're denying the Holy Spirit, because that's its purpose. If you say there is no continuity problem, how can you say there's a Holy Spirit? Because the Holy Spirit wouldn't have any purpose then. So, of course, they're denying the Holy Spirit. Of course. And maybe it's time that they get taught a lesson. You know, they're used to teaching everyone else a lesson. Maybe it's time they get a lesson. It'd be good for them, you know, very good for them, actually. Absolutely, the lessons the Holy Spirit teaches are very good for everyone. You know, maybe it's time they take a second look at their whole scheme, you know, their whole scheme of planets, of space, of commerce, of bodies, of races, of form, of process, of time and space and location and duration, form, process. Reevaluate the whole situation. What is this really? Do we really need all this in order to be? Do we need specific appearances in order to be, in order for to be what we are, in order for to be? Is that really true, or is that nonsense? What is sin? Sin is believing that there are forces that God did not create. That's sin. Did God create process? No. Did not. Did God create time? No. Space? No. Form? No. God created freedom, absolute freedom, in essence and idea, the play of absolute freedom in being and pure spaciousness with the formless essence and idea. So when we say there's time, space, form, and process, we're saying that there's all these laws exist which God did not create. And this is what we call being a sinner. Because if we trust and have faith and believe in these so-called laws of appearance, laws of functionality, of our functionality, that God did not create any of these laws, we don't have the authority to be creating laws about our own being that define our being for us. God's the one that sets the parameters of our being. It's not up to us to do that. So that means we're sinners, definitely. It means we have a severe continuity problem because we've been believing that these laws are functioning for so long, and they're not. And we just say, whoa, I can't function without these laws. You know, I can't function without process. What are you talking about? I can't function without being a body. I can't function without identifying with form. I can't function without time, believing in time. I can't function without location, space. I can't function with that. We say we have to have that in order to be what we are, and that is not true. Since none of these laws exist at all, when we believe they do, we're actually setting up what we call death, because we think that without them, we'll be annihilated. There won't be any us. There won't be any being without these laws. If we believe that, then we fear our own death. We fear death. Because the fact is, deep down, we know, we get this feeling like these laws actually are going to vanish. Vanish. We can't seem to sustain them. And when we feel that if they vanish, we will vanish with them, you see. When we identify with body, form, world, time, space, process, location, duration, we feel we're going to die. we feel that there's some horrible death that is chasing us. That is coming after us somehow. It seems like it's everywhere. You know, we feel vulnerable to death, annihilation, because we're defining ourselves through laws that don't exist at all, have no existence whatsoever. We define ourselves as using time that doesn't exist. That definition doesn't exist. So of course we're going to fear annihilation. And we'll try and defend against that by, you know, having the body die, and they say, well, it's a little death here. At least it's, you know, at least we're following the laws, you know. Oh man. So when we follow all these laws that don't exist, we have developed a continuity problem, because we feel without these laws we'll cease to exist. Or we say without these laws we will experience pure happiness forever. And here we are used to cowering in fear of death constantly, and suddenly that's absolutely vanished, as if it never was. And in its place is this radiant, pure happiness that extends forever and forever. Now, this is what we would call a continuity shift, a continuity problem. To shift from one to the other instantly like that, that is what we get jittery about. Because that's literally a shift that could happen if we didn't use gradualism of the Holy Spirit. We would literally shift from cowering in absolute dread of annihilation, of our own annihilation, feeling as inevitable, feeling that we're being tormented by this and desperately trying to forestall it. We go from that to that vanishes as if it never was, and in its place is this radiant, pure happiness forever and ever, just this pure, perfect, pure happiness and safety and love and freedom without any possibility to be otherwise. That's a huge day and night, you know, difference. So of course we have a continuity problem. It's the only problem we have, because we could make this shift instantly, because none of these laws exist. They've never existed. There's nothing to get rid of, actually. We don't have to defeat time or space or process or form. Time, space, process, form, duration, location. We don't need to defeat any of that, because none of it exists. Our effort to defeat it is actually an expression of our continuity fear, because we say we don't want to be without. We want to keep believing it. If you're trying to defeat something, you're believing that it exists. Nobody tries to defeat something that doesn't exist, do we? So, by saying that we're trying to defeat time, we're trying to defeat form, we're trying to you know, get rid of it, that means it's, you believe it's there, which just reinforces, you know, your feeling of safety from pure happiness. It's when you stop trying to do anything, that's what we're afraid of. Yes. Yeah, when we don't have any problems, well, we love the imaginary problems of time, space, process, and form, because it keeps that continuity fear, you know, in the background. Like we're saying, don't worry, I'm not going to drop any of this, don't worry. So, a lot of the spiritual path says, I'm going to overcome this, I'm going to overcome time, I'm going to transcend time and space. Now, it's not about transcendence. It's not about transcendence or progress at all. It's not about evolution at all. It's not about learning at all. There's nothing there. There are no such laws. There are no such laws at all. Have never been. We have simply been imagining it. And sequencing our appearance, sequencing it as if those laws actually existed. We've been creatively doing this for so long, like there's this world here of form and process, time, space, form and process. No, there isn't any such world. There's nothing being held together by any laws whatsoever, actually. There is no universe. There's no universe being held together with any laws of appearance at all. We are simply creatively desiring an appearance so that it seems as though it infers, we infer, plausibly infer, that there are these laws that are holding it together. But there aren't any such laws. There's nothing holding it together. There's nothing holding all this appearance we call the universe together other than our own desire to experience this. And therefore it is. Therefore it is. Therefore it is, you see. And so, of course, we think, wait a minute, if I stop trying to keep convincing myself that these laws exist, I might realize they don't. And then what would happen? Oh, pure happiness. I you see, that'd be easy for them to just shift and say, wow, they don't exist. Death doesn't exist. There is no fear, nothing to fear. I have no fear of loss of being whatsoever. Loss of being can't possibly happen. So, poof, gone. All fear vanished forever. This is what can happen. Obviously, we're jittery about that. So, we take this gradual path of steps. The Holy Spirit knows and works with us. And subtly, the Holy Spirit's miracles are generally very subtle. And it has to even draw your attention to them to even see it. He says, look here. Look over there, just notice something. What do you notice? That's how I always used to get it. For some reason, I kind of got lazy or somehow stopped. I just felt like I want something more bigger, you know, instead of these real subtle stuff. So I stopped noticing what the Holy Spirit was doing. But the Holy Spirit used to say, just look, turn your attention over here. It was attention. It says, shift your attention to this and just keep it there, okay? I say, okay. And then suddenly I noticed something. I just say, wow, that was very subtle, but I saw it. Very, very subtle indeed. And so I started seeing all the subtlety that's going on in the world, actually. And then how the Holy Spirit, I realized the Holy Spirit's totally aware of all the subtlety, completely aware of all everything. Because it would tell me, I want you to look right here and tell me what you notice. And then I'd see something, I said, that's amazing. How did you know that was going to happen? It's so subtle. It just happened like that, and that's gone, you know, gone. Holy Spirit knew exactly when it was going to happen, where it was going to happen, and told me, put your attention there. So I had many, many, many years like that. But then I've gone many, many years not doing that. I don't know if I got lazy or if I was just convinced. I was convinced the Holy Spirit, yeah, you really do know everything. Because I went through a time where it was just so amazing, I can't even hardly describe it. The Holy Spirit would tell me to go places. And I say, why is this crazy? It's raining. It's so cloudy. This is horrible. No, go to some place. I said, wow, okay. I get there. It's horrible. It's terrible. And he says, walk over here, right here. And put your attention right here. And then I get there, and suddenly, somehow there's a hole in the clouds, and the light is streaming through the clouds, and it's warm and beautiful. And it's like the only place around that's like that. And it only lasts for just that short time that I was there. That happened to me. Stuff like that happened all the time. I said, how did you know exactly how the weather was going to be at this exact place on the earth and told me to go there at the exact time? The weather, the place, the time, the Holy Spirit knew it in ahead of time. It knows everything that's going to happen ahead of time. Well, Jesus says, to all the way to the end of time. It knows how everything's going to, what's going to happen everywhere. Every detail that will ever happen, the Holy Spirit knows. Now, I don't think you can get a supercomputer to give you that. Can you? So the interlopers here in this world, the rebellious spirits who believe that they're going to take over this planet, well, their supercomputers can't deal with this at all. It's overmatched. And so I may have just been so convinced, I said, okay, let's just get to work now. Okay, I believe you really do know. Because I've not had that for a long time. I don't really, you know, but maybe I need to get back to that. I don't know. Very interesting. Certainly, your attention is all important. Where do you play? Stop looking at the news. Stop watching the news. Stop looking at all the negative stuff. We got to do something positive. We already know the negative, but let's introduce the positive, okay? You can't introduce the positive if you're all dragged down by the negative. And what you have to realize, the negative will never prevail, okay? When I saw the vision of oneness, I realized nobody's in the slightest bit of trouble. There are no laws binding any of us. Don't exist. They've never existed. There is no pit of layers and levels. No one's in the slightest trouble at all. There is no trouble for any of us. None. So all this darkness and tragedy and death, none of that is going to prevail. Okay? It's all a dream. You will awaken from the dream. The Holy Spirit will awaken you from the dream for sure. So we need to introduce that fact to the world and say, hey world, you know, I know everything looks just terrible and dark and all this stuff, the darkness is coming upon, you know, but you will awaken from this dream. It will not prevail. It will not prevail. The positive will lift you out of that for sure. For sure. Right? The world, you know, will it go through some trouble? Well, we'll see. You know, many say that it will. But it will not, whatever happens in this world, the world itself, the belief in the world itself will not prevail. The belief that there's a pit that you're in will not prevail. You will realize there is no pit. There has never been any pit. You didn't fall into anything. You didn't fall out of grace. You didn't fall anywhere. There is no law of falling out of God. God is everywhere. You can't fall out of God. You can't fall out of pure spaciousness. You can't disappear from pure spaciousness. You can't turn your back on pure spaciousness. Just try. Try wherever you are. Try turning your back. Have you turned your back on pure spaciousness, which is omnipresent? Or are you still 100% present in pure spaciousness? So, the positive truth will prevail, will prevail. So, what's going to happen with me? I don't know. I have some positive hopes, you know, but my life's never seemed to, you know, I've always had positive hopes. So, it doesn't mean that it's going to happen. It doesn't mean it will not happen. It doesn't mean it will not happen. I don't know. We just have to wake up the next day and see how it goes. See how it goes. Maintain the discipline in your life. The Holy Spirit says, stop watching the news. Stop watching the news. If it says, get rid of your TV, get rid of the TV. If it says, go play golf at 6 in the afternoon, go play golf at 6 in the afternoon. If it says, you know, this, you know, go for it. It may seem unorthodox. You know, I believe the next 2 years will be very unorthodox here in this world. It's going to be a time of you know, great unorthodoxy, so to speak. Just expect it. You know, and look in hindsight, we look back to say, wow, that was quite profound, right? So, in looking back, we will say, wow, that was very, very profound. All right. Stay positive. God bless. And do not despair. Because it's the ego that's despairing right now. That's it.